Russell, we got this thing started. So, Russell, I'm a big MMA fan, UFC well. Fan.
Well, you got a couple of things behind that. Number one is with the UFC, it actually is a sport, combat sport.
Right.
So there's rule sets there. One of the rule sets is no small joint locks.
Huh.
All right. Small joints can be broken very easily. So you always notice that they'll always lock from the wrist up.
Right.
All right. So it's arm bars, mm-hmm. Triangle chokes, knee bars, things like that.
Right.
You never see them do a finger lock. And here's why. You mind if I'll leave it like it is.
Yes, please, God.
Way, right. All right. If you basically take, the only way you can break a joint is to isolate a joint. So if I take one finger and lock down on it and start cranking, I'm going to get the same response from you, but chances are I can very well go beyond the point of no return and break that.
Right.
That's why you don't see him peel a finger off, from a rear naked choke there, because it works very well,
yeah. But
also usually breaks this thing. Well, they don't want that to happen in sports.
Sure. Okay.
Street, fantastic. But the problem on the street is, once I do that, if you're choking me, that's one thing. Liability-wise, then I can go to higher level. If I break that, then we're even. But as you were just getting ready to put hands on me or so forth, mm-hmm. or just a high five, if I crack that thing, guess what? Now I'm paying for your medical fees. It's not. There's a whole different rule set when you're on the street, because the simple is there are no rules in the street.
Right.
All right. There's only a liability set one way or the other. Now, if you're choking me, I get to go to a higher, even but one step above level to basically get control of you.
So you see the guys, there's a huge difference, and not only are there massive differences in these different concepts and styles and techniques, but there's different times when it's appropriate. And
exactly the case.
And what's more is you will teach all those appropriate things in the appropriate spot, right?
That's correct. That is correct. So you know what peg fits in what hole and what time.
Exactly. You've helped out SWAT team members and law enforcement and military personnel and these type of things, right?
As well, private security, what most people call bodyguards or executive protection. But then on the other side of the gamut, we've done family protection, done with family. So I've got some nationally rated fighters here, some guys who won titles here that actually compete full contact. So even MMA, has been kind of new to the public for maybe the last 10 years or so. It's not us. We've been doing our integrated martial arts for a long time.
On top of that, there's also kids that come in here and learn the basic stuff.
And see, there again is a difference of inappropriateness. Now, mm-hmm. me teaching basically something like that for an adult, so I've got adult against another adult, mm-hmm. different high level.
Right.
But now Johnny on the playground at 6 years old doesn't need that sort of thing to stop Billy. So you make everything basically specific to the individual and the scenario. So our kids program, we've had this for going on 22 years. It focuses on them with their developmental stage at their basically, maturity level and their physical ability. The juniors or teens class is a different step above. It's a little differently. The adults, another completely different class because, again, adult situation, I'm not worried about mom or dad being bullied on the playground.
Right.
If they're being bullied, it's probably a full-on assault of some kind.
Right.
So that situation dictates a different response. Mm-hmm. Then I got my guys who want to compete and want to go fight full contact, and we train for that as well.
Me, I'm never going to be an MMA cage fighter. Chances of that happening are really slim, Russ.
And it's not necessary that you can still train like one and get the benefits of that and also get the tools. We talk about the body-mind-spirit connection. The body's the physical training we actually do.
Right.
The mind is the mental aspects because, you actually have a set skill base that you're learning. I mean, it's technical.
Guys, it don't matter what your need is, if it's protecting your family, if you've got the drive to be an MMA fighter, if you're looking for those kinds of things that maybe you just want to drop a couple pounds,
absolutely.
We can all work it out, and it's right here at United Arts. Russell, thank you. Why don't we take a look around real quick?
I'd be glad to. Let me show you around.
Right on. Well, Russell, we're doing one of my favorite things now, and that's just sitting down. but tell us a little bit about where there's desk in here and there's a table and maps, and I see educational tools and things like that on the wall, but this is a gym or a...
Actually, it's a studio. So it's a training facility as well as an educational facility. So this is actually the kids' study room. Before or between classes, depending on how the family is, sometimes the kids get dropped off and get picked up maybe an hour or so after class because mm-hmm. of mom's schedule or so forth. This will be used for a study room. So kids come in here and work on their homework mm-hmm. as well as a snack room. So the snacks we have available for them, they can come in here and eat and quite often socialize. So it's really more of an area for them to kind of work that aspect, because we really can push that academics of that side.
You've actually put a room in here for these kids to do their homework and eat their snacks and really take care of that mental side.
Absolutely. A lot of this is really letting them know that it can learn and can be fun. It should be. And often, a lot of the boys and girls that are maybe good at one subject and not the other, they learn to basically, as we train out here, the partner concept, learn from one another. So if I have one kid who's having problems with math, often there's another child here who's straight A student math, so they help each other and offset that. So it's kind of our, mutual beneficiality kind of concept.
Your learning's never stopped. Get out here and learn something that's actually valuable for you.
If you think from learning combat conflict, often the primary battles you'll have throughout your life, especially the kids, is a lot of something's internal. You know, am I going to be influenced by this group of peers, mm-hmm. you know, or not? You know, off the time, the greatest conflicts and battles you ever go through is internal. You know, what am I going to do at this time in my life? You know, should I, should I not? Sure. And that's combat in of itself. And so the more you work that mind, that body spirit connection out, the more you're prepared to even deal with those.
Right on. Look, guys, there's a lot of information here, and it could save your life. It could save your family's life.
Even the psychological effect of even surviving through something like that is it can be devastating. It can be life changing. So, you know, we'd rather avoid it at all costs. And then if we have no other choice, then we have to have reactive measures in place to take care of ourselves. You know, and otherwise, it's sort of a great stress relief. You know, it's just a great fun time. You know, what a nice atmosphere. It's very family based. For the more diversity you have, from, you know, 1 minute I have a guy who's 6 foot plus, next minute I have basically a 4 foot, you know, lady, mother, two or so forth. You learn so much from each other.
In good time.
Right. That's true.
All right. So, Russ, we moved into the weight room. Now, this is something I'm a little familiar with because that's a lot of what we did in high school. Right. Long practice was weightlifting.
We do have a lot of the good base equipment to we do cross training with, but what we're more focused on is functional fitness. Okay. That's real world muscle that is used on an everyday basis. All right. So, you know, you can go bench press so much, but then can you go throw hay bales for the next basic hour? And so that's more functional. Take a guy with a 10-pound medicine ball and start going out there working functional fitness and burn someone out even faster. People see the UFC type style, the weights, you know, or the weights on one side, and then you have the tires, the resistance, the bag work, whether, you know, you can lift. But we look at being more power orientated, okay? I want basically strength, explosion, okay, and pliability. And I've got to be able to do that, but I've got to do it for a while, so I've got to work on not only range of motion, I've got to work on basically stamina, muscle endurance, if you will, okay, cardiovascular, okay, and I've got to be able to push that. So there's where the functional fitness comes in,
sure.
And really try to make it more personalized.
This guy right here knows what he's talking about. He's very knowledgeable. He's well trained.
We'll take you back to the combat fit room and show you the rest of that stuff.
Right on.
So this is the combat fit room. So we do just a myriad of things, and it's just 1 minute, you know, we might be working medicine ball, next minute kettlebells. Again, the body's just continuing to adjust, and it's working under pressure at all times. So that adrenaline stress becomes the norm. Mm-hmm. So that's where the body, the heart, you know, what we call that strength of character, that spirit, because there's moments where, you know, you know you're about to want to give up. I just got to. Your partner's there with you, and, you know, that bell is ticking. All of a sudden, you know, well, you only got 10 seconds left, man. You know, don't give up on yourself. Right. So eventually you start learning how to basically become, that becomes part of your living ethos, you know.
Sure.
I ain't giving up, you know. I got 10 more seconds. I can make 10 seconds.
Yeah.
You know, it's really diverse. It was more not so much who it is, it's really the proficiency that get them into this room.
Right.
We start out there, build up. When we know that they're competent and confident about what they're doing, then we know we can bring them here, because number one thing is safety.
Right.
I just happened to get in martial arts many, many years ago, and that was my outlet. And I had great instructors, starting with my original instructor, Grandmaster Roy Williams. And then as I, you know, progressed, he sent me to his instructor. So it became like that old apprenticeship. Sure. And the only thing they ever ask in return is how I represented them and what we did, and really be an ambassador of the arts. And help others. Mm-hmm. As he once told me, he said, you want to do something, the most wonderful thing in the world? Take someone and introduce them to their own potential and show them how to develop it to its fullest. Now you've changed the world for the positive. And so for over the years, I've been very spoiled to have all these great people who I used to read about in magazines, mm-hmm. have become basically mentors or friends or you know, confidence of mine over the years. So if I have a good vision of the world and I'm you know, and anything I know, it's because I've been standing on the shoulder of giants for years. It's wonderful to see others succeed. If you believe, you can. And I'll show you the way. All you got to do is do the work. If nothing else, it's a great way to work out and have a good social time. And you know, there's just so many benefits.
Like you said, to help people not just physically to get fit, not mentally to prepare their family or provide for their family or whatever, and not just in a spiritual way where you just feel better about who you are as a person. You do a great job, man. You know a ton of stuff, and it seems like this is your passion, and your passion is to spread the knowledge. All I'm telling you, you know this, it's a humble guy, and we talked about humility and the importance of it, but luckily for you, I get to be here, and I get to tell people whatever I want to, and you know, if you ain't going to toot your horn.